our analysts, our correspondents. Guys, thanks very much for joining us. Let's talk a little bit about the Attorney General of the United States. You cover the Justice Department, Laura Jarrett, for us. The President of the United States basically told him, launch a full-scale, potentially criminal investigation. Who wrote that article in the New York Times? What are you hearing? What's the reaction you're getting?
Well, here's the thing. In order for the Attorney General to launch an investigation, there has to be a crime. And neither the President nor anyone else in his administration has pointed to any criminal wrongdoing. The Attorney General can't just open an investigation because the President is embarrassed or that this shows some sort of disloyalty. And as Preet Bharara, the former U.S. Attorney, pointed out on your program just minutes ago, unless there's some allegation that someone leaked something classified, which we have no evidence that happened, there's no there for the Justice Department.
Because the President, Rebecca Burks, seems to think the Justice Department and the Attorney General, they are there to serve the President's personal political agenda, other requirements. Does he not understand the role of the Justice Department and the Attorney General?
Well, that's what it seems like, Wolf. I mean, just within the past week, we have another data point you can look at, which was the President's tweet about Chris Collins and Duncan Hunter, the two congressmen who were recently charged with crimes by the Justice Department. And President Trump suggested in his tweet that the Justice Department should have held off on charging those two men until after the election, considering Republicans' political prospects in the midterm elections. And so time and again, the President has shown a complete disregard for the independence of the Justice Department and has seemingly ignored or failed to understand that the Justice Department doesn't work for him personally. He is not the chief executive of this government. They are working for the American people as well.
And in that tweet, he was calling it the Jeff Sessions Justice Department, berating Jeff Sessions. Doesn't Jeff Sessions understand that the Republicans need every vote they can get? These two congressmen who have been charged with serious crimes, they had easy elections, not necessarily all that easy. So he was clearly upset about that. And he goes, Susan Hennessey, the President also suggested that whoever wrote that article in the New York Times may have committed treason. So explain to our viewers, because you're a legal expert, what that means, treason.
Well, as a technical legal matter, treason requires that we actually be at war. So you wage war against the United States, or you provide aid and comfort to the enemy. So this is clearly not a situation in which actual legal treason is at issue. You know, beyond that, though, whenever we think about treason, we think about treason in sort of the colloquial sense as a betrayal of the United States. Donald Trump is not the United States. Donald Trump is just a guy who works for us. And so whenever Trump equates a personal betrayal, a personal embarrassment, with betrayal of the nation, when he talks about it being a national security issue, as opposed to an embarrassing talking point for the White House, that really is a profound erosion and a real misunderstanding about the fundamental role of the President of the United States in our constitutional structure.
And Ron Brownstein, I want you and our viewers to listen. The President, only a little while ago, he spoke out once again about all of this. Listen to this.
Hey, Mike and John, could you do me a favor? Create some libel laws that when people say stuff bad about you, you can sue them, and if you're right, you win. Would you please do that? Wouldn't that be nice?
Talking about Mike Rounds and John Thune, two senators. But go ahead. What did you think?
Well, first of all, the way he talks about treason and how often he uses that word really underscores my belief that in many ways he sees himself as a wartime president, only that the war is against essentially blue America and all the Americans and parts of America that are outside of his core coalition. But on the libel laws, I mean, it fits in with, you know, what Rebecca was talking about and everyone else, a kind of this broader pattern that we have seen since day one, that the president works to delegitimize, undermine, hollow out from the inside any institution that he believes can threaten him or resist what he wants. And that ranges from the independent judiciary to the media. And you know, it is interesting that you have the two Republican senators up there on the stage having to kind of now answer what they think about that. They have allowed themselves to be pulled into these waters day by day, week by week, by not resisting or raising objections each time that the president shatters a norm about the execution of the use of executive power or the independent administration of justice. And I think he has correctly taken the message that no matter how far he goes, they will paddle after him.
You know, Susan and Laura, you're both lawyers, so you appreciate the president saying to these two Republicans that Do me a favor, create some libel laws that when people say something bad about you, you can sue them, and if you're right, you win. Create some, he wants the Senate to take up the whole issue of libel.
Right, and whenever the president talks about bulking up or creating new libel laws, he's talking about an assault on the First Amendment. The way we think about libel, we bifurcate it. We think about two different groups of people, private individuals that are entitled to additional protection and public individuals that are only entitled to a very, very limited amount of protection. And this is in order to protect the First Amendment, to protect the rights of a free press, because it is so important in order to hold our leaders accountable. Donald Trump is no longer a private person. He is a public individual. He is accountable to the American people. And so whenever he talks about sort of using Congress and wanting Congress to protect him, it's part and parcel of this larger theme of him just not being able to understand that, you know, he's not just Donald Trump anymore. He's the president.
Go ahead.
But libel laws are a function of state laws. It's always this constant push and pull where he throws around legal terms and legal concepts on things that don't apply. It's kind of confounding. I think he uses it as sort of an imprimatur of authority or something that sort of adds some gravitas on things that really have no applicability whatsoever.
You would think, Rebecca, the president would be well briefed about libel laws in the United States, what treason actually means, but he's throwing out all of these ideas apparently because he's seething not only because of this op-ed in the New York Times, but also the Bob Woodward book that's about to come out officially. We've all been seeing some excerpts in recent days. And I take it he's still very upset about the very, very extraordinary funeral that was accorded to Senator John McCain.
That's right. It's been a difficult week or so in the world of Donald Trump from his perspective. He feels, and there have been other points in his presidency where this has also been the case. It's sort of this bunker mentality for Donald Trump right now. He feels like he's under assault from all sides. And when he feels trapped in that way, he starts to lash out. He starts to go on these rants, as we've seen at some rallies, and, you know, bring up these legal terms that maybe he's not serious about Congress wanting to pass these laws. But it's still disturbing to hear this language from the president of the United States.
Go ahead, Ron.
You know, Wolf, it's interesting to think about the political impact of all of this. I mean, every time the president, you know, goes down one of these roads of kind of threatening the independent administration of justice, he basically justifies it by arguing that there's a deep state conspiracy to thwart me. And by thwarting me, they are attempting, he says to his supporters, to kind of force you back into a corner, to sublimate you. And there may be an audience for that argument in parts of his coalition. The problem they've got is that that argument simultaneously increases the anxiety among many of the suburban swing voters who, as we talked about before, are critical in the battle for the House, that there are no effective checks on this president. So these kinds of very polarizing, kind of vague legal arguments that he's making may simultaneously have the effect of activating some of his supporters, but also driving away more of the